The biggest change taking place in software is the move to the graphical environment.
In the mid-90s, businesses faced rising IT costs and complexity. The answer, server-based computing, running apps on powerful terminal servers connecting from simple thin clients. Come with me to explore 1998's Windows NT 4.0 Terminal Server Edition. Let's talk about legacy network technology. I'm the Vintage Collector and these are my stories. In the mid-1990s, enterprises were exploring server-based computing to cut costs. The idea was to run applications centrally on powerful servers and use inexpensive thin clients at the desks. Microsoft and its partners promoted Windows-based terminals and the NetPC concept, essentially recreating a modern architecture reminiscent of early Unix mainframe terminals. While those older systems were all character-based, this new generation of terminals and thin clients were centered around graphical environments. Under this vision, there'd no longer be a need for a full-featured PC on every desktop. A minimal, underpowered device, just enough to connect to a network, could act as a remote display to a Windows terminal server. You've seen examples of this before on the channel, like Sun Microsystems Sunray terminals or the Eagle Thin client. Those mid-2000 systems already supported features like audio forwarding, which had become standard by then, but those features were missing from the earliest version of Windows Terminal Services. The original release of Windows NT 4.0 Terminal Server Edition in 1998 launched around the same time as Citrix MetaFrame 1.0. This was actually the result of a 5-year multi-million dollar partnership between Microsoft and Citrix. Citrix had previously licensed the source code to Windows NT 3.51 to build WinFrame, essentially its own multi-user operating system based on NT. But even earlier, Citrix offered Citrix Multi-User, a customized version of Microsoft OS 2.1.21 focused on multi-user text mode sessions. That OS lacked the presentation manager and was limited to character-based applications. And it came to an abrupt end when Microsoft and IBM ended their joint development of OS 2. Still, Citrix pushed out Multi-User 2.0 in 1992. But the future clearly laid in Windows NT, which, before the split, had even been known as NT OS 2 3.0. WinFrame, based on NT 3.51, introduced MultiWin, Citrix's core technology that added true multi-user multi-session support, including session isolation, to the Windows NT kernel. MultiWin allowed multiple interactive desktop sessions to run simultaneously on one NT system, something native NT wasn't designed for. Citrix also evolved its independent computing architecture, or ICA, which had started back in the OS 2 era. As NT 4.0 was being developed, Microsoft licensed MultiWin to integrate it into Windows NT and create its own built-in terminal services derived from that foundation. Microsoft's version used the Remote Desktop Protocol RDP instead of ICA. It initially lacked features like audio redirection or local device redirection. The latter essentially prohibited using your own locally connected printer. In contrast, ICA was more feature-rich and readily supported audio, printer redirection and non-TCP/IP transport protocols, including support for IPX, SPX, NetBUI and even asynchronous serial lines, making it far more adaptable in legacy enterprise environments.
In other words, Citrix did what Microsoft didn't, made the thing usable.
Unlike WinFrame, which was its own modified NT build, MetaFrame was simply a software add-on you could install on top of an existing NT 4.0 Terminal Server Edition. But today, we're not diving into Citrix MetaFrame or ICA, we're focusing on the vanilla Windows NT 4.0 Terminal Server Edition, which, as you might imagine, was a lot more basic. Still, unlike today, where the core of Windows Terminal Services is even available as a trimmed-down feature for remote administration even on the consumer versions of Windows, it was fully absent from the original workstation and server releases of Windows NT 4.0. Windows NT 4.0 Terminal Server Edition was a completely separated and distinct development branch, close but not fully identical to the NT main branches. This is not only visible from the visually different Windows setup, but also later on in various other areas. You can apply most regular NT 4.0 patches even through Windows Update. Of course, Windows Update for NT is long gone, so I'm using here the WindowsUpdateRestore.com as a showcase, but the experience is the same. But that isn't universally true. As mentioned, NT 4.0 Terminal Server Edition differs, and so you can't apply all standard NT 4.0 patches in all cases. Some would definitely refuse to install. That also includes the service packs. For the latter, Microsoft had released distinct versions targeted exclusively at the Terminal Server Edition. And you see it here, but also elsewhere later on, that for some applications, or even a service pack, you need to place the Terminal Server into so-called install mode. According to Microsoft's documentation, install mode captures any registry changes made under the HKEY current user hive. This is a requirement to make those registry changes available to all remotely connected users, essentially redirecting them to a global location in HKEY local machine instead. While some applications may offer to switch the server into install mode themselves, others may not. And there might be even software installers not even checking if they run on a terminal server or not. So it's best to always force the server into install mode manually, easily done via the command prompt using the change user slash install command. This also unlocks any add-ons refusing to install from Windows Update. Going back to the basic NT 4.0 installation, I noticed it offered the option to install the server as a domain controller. Now, I never personally deployed any NT 4.0 terminal server environments. My earliest exposure came with Windows 2000, where I learned during my MCP certification that I was strongly advised against running a terminal server concurrently with a domain controller on the same machine. Of course, Windows 2000 and its Active Directory were significantly more demanding than the older NT 4 domain model, but I'd imagine similar best practice guidance applied even in NT 4 TSC environments. It might still have made sense in smaller office environments with just a few users though, especially when budget constraints made separate servers unobtainium. Now, looking around in NT 4.0 TSE, you'll notice that the start menu lacks a shutdown option. It only has log off. On purpose.
Because letting Barry from accounting accidentally shut down the terminal server was probably less than ideal.
Even as an administrator, to shut down or reboot, you'd use the shutdown command in the command prompt. It also broadcasts a message to all connected users warning of the imminent shutdown, quite similar to how it's done on Unix and Unix-like systems. Besides that, you'll find a few extra tools not present in the standard NT 4.0 server release. Besides the License Manager, you'll also find the Connection Manager, which lets you inspect connected clients, active sessions, and running processes. In addition, TSE includes a set of command line tools beyond the change command we saw earlier, mostly aimed at managing sessions from the command line. One particularly notable tool is the Shadow command, which allows you to monitor another user's terminal session for administration and support purposes. Let's have a word about License Manager, used to manage client access and terminal licenses. Because Microsoft's license model was, frankly, super complicated. Citrix, for comparison, had a much simpler concurrent user licensing model. You might pay around $6,000 for 15 concurrent seats, or roughly $375 per user. Microsoft's approach was far more layered. First, every user or device needed a standard client access license to connect to shared resources like file shares or printers. But that, Carl, didn't offer terminal server access. For that, you also needed a terminal server call. The only exception was Windows NT 4.0 Workstation, which included the TS call writes automatically. There was also a Workstation upgrade license for Windows 95 and 98 clients, intended to make the license compliant without needing a full TS call. It was reportedly cheaper, but also short-lived. Eventually, Microsoft required Win9x clients to have a proper TS call too.
Because of course, why sell one license when you can sell two?
Even with the price variability, depending on your licensing program, one thing is clear, it wasn't cheap. Still, many companies justified the extra cost for using inexpensive thin clients over full-blown PCs, recouping the licensing overhead in client-side hardware savings. On the other hand, the servers had to be really beefed up to support a reasonable amount of concurrent users. NT 4.0 TSE was definitely a departure from the minimum system requirements observed for NT 4.0, asking far more than just the minimum 486 CPU with 16 to 24 MB of RAM. Typically, machines required to run an NT terminal server would impose a dual CPU configuration and a much higher amount of RAM. Unfortunately, most of the NT 4.0 TSE sizing documents have vanished and are unretrievable on the present day, but here's some indicative calculations of Windows 2000 with terminal services. Putting that back into perspective for 1998, an NT 4.0 terminal server was likely to be built around 1 or 2 Pentium 2 class CPUs in the 4 to 500 MHz clock range, as was current for the time. Besides for the basic memory requirements of 32 MB, you need to calculate at least 4 MB per user session, plus additional on-top application memory. Said that, for a server required to support 16 fairly moderate concurrent users, one could probably get away with as low as 96 to 120 MB of RAM on the lower end. But chances are, the terminal servers of the time were stocked with larger memory configurations. However, it wasn't all about CPU and RAM only, but also about network bandwidth. This analysis here shows the typical work in a word processor would require up to 200 kilobits constantly, whereas browsing the web with lots of scrolling, images and animations would bring the per session traffic up to as high as 2 megabits just for the screen updates. So having a switched 100 megabits Ethernet network was definitely a minimum requirement here. And how did things look from the client side? Let's take this NT 4.0 workstation as an example. And yes, I know, it's a German localized version again, but don't let that distract you. An important thing to remember is that Windows NT 4.0 didn't come with a built-in remote desktop client. After all, Terminal Server Edition didn't even exist when NT 4.0 launched in 1996. It only came 2 years later. To connect to a Terminal Server, you had to install the Windows Terminal Services client separately, which was also available for Windows 9X. You could use it to manually connect to a server, or admins could provide pre-configured connection profiles. As shown here, it even supported saving login credentials and launching in full screen mode so it could fully overlay your local desktop. Alternatively, a session could be configured to launch just a single application like the Windows Calculator. But seamless window integration simply didn't exist yet, so it would be confined to the terminal client window. Compare that to today, where terminal applications can be streamed right into your local desktop environment so smoothly you might not even notice they're remote. To the very last, since I already showcased that Eagle Thin client in a few of my earlier videos on Windows XP Embedded and Windows Fundamentals for legacy PCs, you might be wondering, can it actually connect to this ancient NT 4.0 terminal server? Well, apparently it can. We've got a fully working terminal environment. And it definitely had its merits. Suddenly, IT admins could realize Windows application management while reducing costs on desktop hardware. And when using thin clients, there was also no more worrying if Barry installed Bunzy Buddy on his PC again. Everything was controlled at the server level. And this became even more tightly integrated with Windows 2000, where terminal service became a standard, albeit optional server component, paired with Active Directory and more powerful than ever domain policies. But it all started here, with a Windows NT offshoot born out of a collaboration between Microsoft and Citrix. How about you? Did you ever work with NT Terminal Services or even Citrix WinFrame or MetaFrame back in the day? Let me know your experiences in the comments below. I'd love to hear them. I'm the Vintage Collector and this was my story for today. And if you enjoy stories like this one, consider supporting the channel with a paid subscription. Even a small monthly pledge helps me keep things running, whether it's fighting dead capacitors, hunting for rare spare parts, or wrestling with stubborn software. Thanks for watching and see you again next Sunday.